So shall we close our eyes and look into the Lord who is in our midst. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this blessed time that you have given us, Father. You alone have gathered us together in your presence. And Lord, it's your presence that makes all the difference. Lord, all our life is vanity if it is not for your presence, Lord. If you doesn't come with us, Lord, what's the purpose in our life? Lord, it is for fellowship with you that you have chosen us from before the foundation of the world. Thank you, Father, for your mercies. Thank you for choosing us. Thank you for predestining us. Thank you for your mercy, for your loving kindness. Thank you for drawing us unto yourself by your loving kindness, Lord. Thank you for that eternal love. Thank you, Jesus. We bow down before you. Cleanse our hearts once again with your blood. And flood our hearts with your Holy Spirit beyond measure. Help us to hear your still small voice as we are in the Spirit, as we are full of the Holy Spirit. Help us to be sensitive to your word that ministers to the deepest needs of our heart. Transform us, Lord Jesus, as we see your glory in the word of God. Yes, Father, thank you for the glorious word that you've given us that exhorts us and encourages and challenges and seeks to lift us up into higher and higher heavenly realm each day. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Father. Thank you that you are going to speak to our hearts and encourage us. In Jesus' precious, sweetest name we pray. Amen. So many weeks we've been looking at the mirror of the word of God in Hebrews, and how glorious is the Lord's image there, so manifest and so clear in the book of Hebrews. How Jesus wants us to have a life of perfect rest, and that rest is that spiritual union with him, that fellowship with him. We can have that rest only if we become one with him. Yesterday also in John's Gospel chapter 4, we were seeing the same thing about worship. This, the real worship is actually the real rest in the most holy place, in the very presence of God. Actually, worship or rest or fellowship or delighting ourselves in the Lord. So many phrases, so many wordings the Word of God is using, but actually all of them points to one thing. Even Tree of Life, simple pure devotion to the Lord, first love, loving the Lord with all our heart. So many expressions the Word of God is giving from so many angles, so that somehow we'll get the revelation of what the Lord wants us to have: eternal life, receiving the glory of Jesus Christ. So many things actually we read in the Word of God. All is pointing to the very one theme that God has created us for. God created us for fellowship with Him, in which we become one with Him and become more and more like Him. And the more we become one with the Lord, the more we will become like the Lord Jesus in our character more and more. And there will be a life of rest. And we were seeing in the book of Hebrews that there is that promise of entering His rest, and that promise is yes in Jesus. 2 Corinthians 1:20 we saw last week, promises of God are yes in Christ, through His power, for His glory. So He gave the promise, and it can be fulfilled only through His power. We can enjoy that through His power, and it is for His glory that He is fulfilling the promises. And so the greatest of all promises is actually, we saw that in 2 Peter 1:4, that to partake of divine nature is the greatest of all promises. What is this partaking of divine nature? It's actually entering His rest. It is actually worshipping the Lord. It is actually that Sabbath rest with the Lord. All are pointing to the same thing. God is love, and God wants to share His love with us. And He created us in His own image so that we can be one with Him. Yesterday also we were seeing that verse in John 4:24, where Jesus says, God is spirit, and those who worship the Lord should worship in spirit and truth. It is just like this is a glass of water, and if you pour oil into that water, it cannot be mixed. Only if further water is poured, it can be mixed, it can become one water. Like that, God is spirit, and in our spirit we need to become one with the Lord. That spiritual union, that is the real worship, and that is the rest, life of rest, the Canaanite life, the life of Canaan, the kingdom of heaven. That is another expression that Jesus himself used. Kingdom of heaven is where? Kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God? Matthew's gospel speaks about the kingdom of heaven, and all the other gospels we read about kingdom of God. Both are one and the same. Where God is the king, where Jesus is the king. And when Jesus is the king of my life, I am one with the Lord. He is the king. Myself is not the king. Myself is surrendered on that golden altar in that holy place of that tabernacle. And we were seeing last week also, you know, how the picture of the tabernacle makes things so much clearer to us. You know, how God has hidden these things from the wise and prudent and have revealed them unto babes. Actually, all these things, I mean, the picture of the tabernacle is there in the Old Testament, and so many things actually we read in the Word of God. If you look intently at the Word of God, we will be able to see the glory of Jesus. You know that verse in James 1:23, no, where it is not just we, you know, just passively, just passingly look at the Word of God, but we need to look intently at the Word of the Lord, the law of liberty. That is in James 1:23 says about Word of God as a mirror, and James 1:23 and James 1:25 rather says, but one who looks intently at the perfect law. The perfect law is the Word of God, and that is Jesus himself, the Word became flesh, Word who became flesh. The one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, that Word of God. If you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Thy word is truth, John 17:17. John 8:32 says, truth shall make you free. So the Word of God is the truth, and the Word of God will make us free, and the Word of God is the Word of liberty. That is the law of liberty. James 1:25, how correlating is all the verses of the Word of God. Law of liberty, and abides by it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer. And this man will be blessed in whatever he does, as we read in Psalm 1:3 also. He prospers in whatever he does. So he who meditates the law, word of the Lord, meditates the law day and night. There we read it, Psalm 1 and verse 2, and he will be prospering in whatever he does. The same thing James 1:25 also says. So actually, what the Lord is seeking to imprint in our hearts is that he created us to have a life of rest, and we can understand things little more clearly if we have that picture of the tabernacle. I believe the tabernacle picture is familiar to all of you, to most of you, if not all of you. That is simple. I mean, actually, you know, in the Old Testament, we read God telling Moses to build a structure where he can dwell among his people. We read that in Exodus 25, verse 8. If we turn to Exodus, book of Exodus, second book of the Bible, chapter 25, and verse 8, let them construct a sanctuary, that is a tabernacle, for me, that I may dwell among them. And in the subsequent verses, God is telling him in great detail how to build the tabernacle. The tabernacle is a symbol of many things. The tabernacle is a symbol of Christ himself, who tabernacled among us, as John 1:14 says. He dwelt among us. That Greek word is keno, which is tabernacle. So Jesus dwelt among us as the tabernacle. Just like in the tabernacle, in the most holy place, the glory of God was there, and God dwelt among them. When Jesus dwelt among us, he tabernacled among us. John 1:14, word became flesh and he dwelt, he tabernacled among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory in the most holy place, the glory of God in Jesus. We beheld his glory, glorious of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. So tabernacle is a picture of Jesus. Tabernacle is a picture of the church. Tabernacle is a picture of our Christian life. Tabernacle is a picture of our being. Tabernacle has got three parts. Outer court is there, outer court. And then if you just Google tabernacle, Old Testament tabernacle or something, you'll get the picture. I wish I could, if I had saved it already and I could project it here. I hope all of you would be familiar with that picture and all. So the outer court is there, then the holy place, then the most holy place. Most holy place is a cubical cube with equal height and length and breadth and height of equal measure. It's a cube, most holy place. And then the outer court, both forming a rectangle, and then the holy place and the most holy place both forming a rectangle, and then the outer court covering that, which speaks of our body, soul and spirit. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says spirit, soul and body. Spirit is most holy place, symbolizes the most holy place, and holy place is symbolized by the soul, and outer court is symbolized by the body. It is not just for some theological understanding or anything, but in order to understand and come to a revelation of living in the spirit, this example has personally helped me a lot, and I believe for all those who ardently study the Word of God would be helped by this example. Why? Because actually in the current portion that we are going to read from Hebrews chapter 4, there also we read about the Word of God in verse 12, and the Word of God pierces the division of the soul and the spirit. So the soul and the soul is actually the holy place, spirit is the most holy place, and there is a division, there is a partition. That word is merismos, partition. There is a separation, and that separation was the veil in the tabernacle. The thick curtain was, the thick veil was there, and that veil we read in Hebrews, all of you, most of you would be familiar with that verse. I would have quoted that empty number of times by then in our Bible studies. Hebrews 10, 19 and 20, if you read the same book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 20, by a new and living way, I'll read 19 and 20. Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place, they denotes the most holy place actually, because it is saying entering through the veil, because entering through the veil is actually to the most holy place only. So what is denoted there, what the author has intended, is actually the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he inaugurated for us through the veil. So, and through the veil, that is his flesh. So the veil that was rent in the temple at Jerusalem when Jesus was crucified, when Jesus breathed his last, we read in the last chapters of Matthew and Luke and Mark and all that, the veil in the temple in Jerusalem was torn from top to bottom. It was not some man tearing from bottom to top, but it was God. It was a symbol of God the Father from heaven. He's tearing from top to bottom. Like that, the veil was torn. And that denotes that, we have an access to the most holy place today through Jesus. In the Old Testament, only the high priest, that too in a year, with much sacrifices and with much, reverential awe, only they could enter the most holy place. And that too, they would be having some kind of a rope attached to the high priest, and the other end of the rope would be held by the people outside, so that in case that high priest drops dead because of some iniquity or something, nobody would be able to enter the most holy place, because they were not allowed to enter like that. And there was this there can be that fierce judgment of God, and people will have to draw him out of the most holy place. That much was the the awe and reverential fear that they had for the presence of God. Today we can confidently come to the throne of grace. If we, the same book of Hebrews chapter 4, last verse says that, therefore let us draw near with confidence to the throne of grace. You know, in the Old Testament, actually, you know, that was called the most mercy seat of the, in the most holy place, there was this mercy seat and all. And, you know, they couldn't really draw near to the mercy seat at all. You know, only the high priest, that too once in a year, that too with so much of precautions and prerequisites, only they could enter. But today, any child of God, any born again child of God, can draw near with confidence, with great confidence, with great boldness. We can, anytime the Lord wants us to dwell there, to enter there and dwell there. But in case we stray away, also we can draw near again with confidence, because we have a merciful High Priest, that is Jesus Himself. That is what we read in the in these verses. Actually, there we read that you know. So I was telling about this. Most holy place, and outer court, and you know how we enter the most holy place. You know, many a time we have even if we hear a thousand times, unless we experience that, it is just like if you say that sugar is sweet, you cannot understand what the sweetness is unless you taste it and see, that the Lord is good. Psalm 34:8. So like that, we need to enter that rest literally. You know, we need to experience that. Then only we'll understand. Really, then only that will be a revelation to us. It is just simple. It is not some complicated thing. But actually, it is the symbolisms of the Word of God and are all very superb and so exact. So that really, you know, encourages us when we see that glory of God, you know, how that is hidden in the Word of God. We read in Proverbs 25:2, there is a verse which says, Proverbs chapter 25, verse 2, it is the glory of God to conceal a matter, but the glory of kings to search out a matter. So God in His glorious wisdom has concealed it. He has hidden it from the wise and intelligent. But we are royal priesthood. We read that in 1 Peter 2:9. We are kings and priests of God. And it is the glory of kings to search out that matter, means actually to get the, receive that revelation on that matter. So, you know, I have heard Brother Zach Pinnon saying like this example, like on the surface of the earth, only this grass and clay and mud, all the cheap things are there. But if you dig deep, the costly metals like gold and diamond and precious stones would be there. So like that, if you just superficially read the Word of God, you won't get any of these treasures. But if you meditate deeper and deeper and deeper, and if you surrender yourselves like little child, and then you get a revelation. As if you humble yourself like a small baby, a little babe, Matthew 11:25, Jesus says, I praise your Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and the prudent and have revealed them unto babes. So that babes, that is a little baby who is so teachable, he doesn't know anything, he has zero pride, he is so humble, he is so restful. And, you know, like that, if we humble ourselves, like, Lord, I do not know anything. Lord, you teach me, Lord. You help me to understand and experience this. Then we will understand. Otherwise, even if we hear a thousand times, it will be, oh, why this tabernacle, all these complicated things, why these people are telling, people would be thinking. But actually, those experience that would understand. So, actually, yesterday also, we were seeing the same thing. I was so happy to see, although the Malayalam and English Bible study, John's Bible study, yesterday, Malayalam Bible study, there also John 4 worship, we were saying the same thing yesterday also about the spiritual union and worshipping the Father. And Hebrews 4 also, we came to the same theme of entering the rest. Both are the same theme only. And I was saying yesterday also that in the holy place, three items are there in the Exodus 25 onwards. If you read those chapters, there you will see three things. Actually, these three things are the faculties of our soul. That is our mind, our thinking capacity, which we can say as a symbol of, which is symbolized by the showbread, table of showbread there. And there was a lampstand also in the holy place. That symbolizes the emotions, the feeling capacity. And close to the veil of the tabernacle was this golden altar, which symbolizes our willpower, our decision making capacity. And how we can enter the most holy place today? We saw in Hebrews 10:20 that veil symbolizes Jesus' flesh. So Jesus' flesh is not Jesus' literal body, because Jesus' literal body was, his body was not literally torn from top to bottom like that. But of course he was pierced, and really crushed and all, but it was not torn like that. So what was torn was his self-will. Jesus said, not my will, but thy will, O Father. So that flesh is actually, if you respell it and remove that H from that, that flesh and self are one and the same. Flesh, self, or our self-will. And if we understand that flesh as our self-will, then we can easily understand what it is actually. Jesus said, not my will, but thy will. And he always humbled himself. And as a symbol of his perfect doing of the Father's will and not his will, his all throughout his life, the flesh, his self-will was torn. And it was, as an attestation to that fact, it was literally torn. The Father tore it from above. That veil at the temple at Jerusalem. So like that in our life also, our life is also, our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. You are the body, temple of the Holy Spirit. We read that in 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 6:19 and all. So our body, just like the Jerusalem temple had this three parts, our being also has these three parts. That is the spirit, soul and body, 1 Thessalonians 5:23. And we also have got this, self-will, that is our thick veil. What really hinders us experiencing and entering that rest and that spiritual union with God and that worshipping of God is our self-will. And if we look at our life, actually what is ruling our life is actually our self-will. My self-will is deciding what I should think and what I should feel and how I should feel. My self-will is deciding what I should think, and thus thoughts will be leading to the emotions, that feelings and all. And according to that thought only, I am using my body also, my eyes and my tongue and my ear and my hands and my feet. I use according to how I think. It is actually governed by the self-will basically in human beings. But actually what God wants us to do is to break that self-will. And he wants to be the king of our life. Our self was the ruler so far. I've been living for myself. And even when I become born again, when I say I repent, what I'm doing is that I'm turning away from my own ways. I'm turning to God. So in order to become born again itself, what the self-will has to be broken to some extent and say that, Lord, I cannot earn my salvation of my own strength or self-will or gritting the teeth or doing some pilgrimages or doing some charity works or doing some religious deeds. I cannot earn my salvation. All my righteousness are like filthy rags. Lord, I am just good for nothing. I can, go. I deserve only eternal hellfire. Like that, we humble ourselves and surrender our lives and say that, Lord, I do not want to live my life my way, but Lord, let your will be done. Like that, I surrender myself and receive Jesus into my heart, and I become born again. And even after becoming born again, this self-will is still remaining, that thick veil. And the thick veil, of course, if we have entered, experienced a glimpse of that God's love and all on and off, but the Lord wants us to enter into that most holy place and dwell over there. And the Lord is trying his level best to tear the self-will of our life through various difficulties. And sometimes it can be some financial difficulties, it can be some interpersonal difficulties, it can be some ailments or some failures in our life, some difficulties in our life, some infirmities, whatever. Through all that, the Lord is trying to humble us, break our self-will, so that the more we humble ourselves and yield our will to the Lord, the Holy Spirit can take over the control of our being. I was crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. So actually, so far I was living, and I humble myself and say that, Lord, not my will. I humble myself as a zero before the Lord and say that, Lord, you be the king of my life. I was crucified with you. When you were crucified, Lord, I was also, myself was also crucified over there. So like Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. That means die to yourself, and then only you can follow me. So Lord, I surrender my will to you, Lord. Like that, the more we surrender our will and humble ourselves before the Lord, what will happen? Actually, when we humble ourselves before the Lord is the Word of God. Jesus is Word of God. And the Word of God is like a two-edged sword. That is what we are reading here.